It really shouldn't come as any surprise that used Macs are more expensive than used PCs. This is a well-known fact, just like the Earth is round, except for now there's the guy you knew from high school on Facebook refuting it. And those things kind of happen, like global pandemics now, apparently, which knock the supply chains out of whack and cause everything to get more expensive, especially in the used electronics market, like GPUs, cars, life in general. So what happens if you want to buy a new, I mean, not new, let's be real, we're going with used, a used Mac that's usable? And we're not going to put a lot of requirements on this. Let's go with it runs the latest OS without hacks, more than 4 gigs of RAM, has a medium amount of storage, and we're doing this for under $300. Well, if you saw the title of this video, you probably already know the answer of what I got, because it's in the thumbnail and in the title, but I'm just trying to create suspense. I'm doing this all because I actually lied. I actually want to run a legacy OS because the hardware in question I want to use is no longer supported under macOS Catalina and above, and none of my computers can run below that. So, with that said, this computer I'm going to be using to run Mojave so I can use it with my Numark NS7 turntables. This is one hell of a DJ controller, and that is because it was one of the first to have motorized platters. When you hit play, the platter turns. Sadly, Numark stopped supporting these in macOS High Sierra. DJ controllers have certainly evolved since this thing, but I'm not a professional DJ and I don't need all the bells and whistle features. And to get a motorized one would cost a lot of money. So let me demonstrate why I love these things and we'll get to the video part. And the best computer I found, the MacBook Air 2015 11-inch. This is not a very powerful computer, I'm going to be honest. It has a 1.6 GHz Core i5 5th generation processor. It has two physical cores and can address 4 threads. The base model comes with 4 gigs of RAM, but I opted to blow a little more of my budget to get the 8GB version. The RAM is not user serviceable. The SSD, on the other hand, is a different story. It came factory with a 128GB SSD, so it's absolutely tiny, and it's not very fast. In fact, none of the factory ones are very fast, so don't pay extra for those. By far for me, the biggest weak link in this whole computer is the display. That is because it's a non-Retina display, and its viewing angles aren't nearly as good as we're used to today. The whole display has a bit of a ghostly look to it when you compare it to a modern MacBook. Lastly, the MacBook uses an integrated GPU, integrated Intel HD 6000 series graphics processor, and it's also not very good, but it's actually driving a pretty low resolution screen, so it's not a big deal. And my damage came out to be $250. The last portion of my budget went to purchasing the cheapest yet brand name SSD that I could, and landed on the Crucial P2 500GB. Now, for no discernible reason that I can figure out, Apple does not use the standard M2 connector for its SSDs. These are the ones like NVMe's use. Instead, they use their own variant called NGFF M-Key. What this means is you have to buy a very cheap adapter so you can plug your SSD into your Mac. That's it. Also, you'll want to buy an NVMe to USB adapter. Basically, it's just an external case for your NVMe drive. I did the thing you're really not supposed to do, which is rely on Amazon reviews and buy the cheapest, highly reviewed product. But it worked out fine. Replacing the SSD is surprisingly easy if you've never done it before. Step 1, put your NVMe drive into your USB case and connect it to your computer. Step 2. Format the drive using the disk utility, download Carbon Copy Cloner, and copy your hard drive's contents to the external drive. This will take a few minutes. Step 3. Turn off your MacBook and then flip it over and grab your P5 pentalobe screwdriver and start removing the screws on the bottom of the case. Step 4. Remove the old SSD. Attach your new SSD to the M2 adapter, then insert it into your MacBook and secure it. Step 5. Put it back all together and you're done. Now this is where I went over my $300 target a bit. The NVMe was $54, the M2 key adapter was $7, and the USB enclosure was $18. This brings my entirely budget Mac to $329. If I was truly desperate, I could return the USB enclosure to Amazon and they'd be none the wiser. And I could have bought a cheaper NVMe drive. Now, this would not be a proper tech video if I didn't provide some benchmarks. So let's benchmark the old SSD versus the new SSD. First, I'm going to show you Blackmagic Disk Speed Test. As you can see, this doesn't really tell you a whole hell of a lot. That is because sequential read and writes are not the most useful thing about your SSD and not usually what you're doing. Rarely are you just writing 4 GB files. For some reason, the Mac community will not let go of this piece of software and you should stop using it. Instead, let's use Amorphous Disk Mark. I ran 3 variations of this test, as you can see on the screen, and the story becomes a little more clear. Across the board, the Apple SSD is just really slow compared to my new NVMe SSD. The only place where the SATA SSD routinely beat the NVMe SSD is the random writes, and that's because this is a DRAMless SSD. Translation, this means it's just a dirt cheap SSD that's not very good. Also, to add insult to injury, Crucial and later versions of this SSD swap from TLC memory to QLC memory, which is slower. I really recommend watching the Linus Tech Tips episode on this very topic. For me personally, this did not matter. I didn't really care because this is not my primary computer. Now, there's 2 things I noticed that were very interesting in these benchmarks, and I'm pretty sure my nerds out there already noticed one of them. The NVMe drive is capped at about PCI 2.0 transfer speeds. If you notice, it's only at 1500 megabytes per second. This particular NVMe should be able to do about 2500 megabytes a second. The other one, again, has to do with the transfer speeds, but it's with the Apple SSD. See if you can figure it out. All right, and I'll give it to you. Those transfer speeds are indicative of a SATA SSD. To test this theory, I reinstalled the original SSD and looked at it using the System Profiler tool. The Apple System Profiler does not report having an NVMe drive installed, but it does report a SATA one. That's weird, right? That's not a SATA drive. Or is it? This is something that some people do not realize, that not all M2 drives are NVMe. M2 is just a format. M2 SSDs can be AHCI, aka SATA, or NVMe. The MacBooks support both, so we're in luck and we're using NVMe, which is a lot faster. Again, using the Apple System Profiler, I can confirm that this is indeed using a PCI 2.0 speed. This computer has been benchmarked many times using other suites of software, so let's just look up the Geekbench for it. And as you can see, it's not very fast, but it's fast enough to run Serato, which I used to record the intro. I also looked at trying to hack in a Retina display. I don't know if that'd work. There is a 11.6-inch 30-pin display. On one of the old white MacBooks, I did replace the display, and it wasn't that hard. But watching a replacement video for the innards on the MacBook Air was enough to dissuade me. So how is my $250 MacBook? In a pinch or in a travel situation where I wasn't willing to lose or risk being stolen, I probably would take this along and it'd work fine. I wouldn't want to do serious media creation on this thing. It would work fine for web development, which is my real job, although it wouldn't be exactly fun. As of recording this, for $329, I just don't think you could really beat this setup. this is the cheapest Mac you could probably get and get away with using as a primary or preferably a secondary computer. The only other vector would be to get a 2008 Mac Pro, but I already know from experience it does not run Serato DJ Pro well. So here we are at the conclusion of my very specific and very odd video about getting a $250 Mac, which I lied about and made $329. Maybe you found this useful?
Now, I usually don't ask anything on my viewers because you guys don't owe me anything, but I'd be curious if you think you have a better budget Mac setup for under $400. You can let me know in the comments, and if it's interesting, I'll reply, and we can have a friendly debate.
Thanks again for watching.